Welcome to worship with First United Church of Oak Park. We're so glad you're here, whether you're a first-time visitor, a long-time member, or somewhere in between. We hope you'll find meaning in our time together today. We are an open and affirming, more light congregation, and so we welcome our LGBTQIA+ folks into every aspect of our life together as a community. And we welcome you, whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey. You are welcome here. We hope that you will take a moment to find the pew pad and let us know you're here. It's a place where you can ask for more information about our church. It's a place where you can enter prayer requests and we will pray for them. It's a place for you to connect. We hope that if you've joined us live at 11 a.m. on Sunday morning, that you'll also use the live chat as a way to connect. Let others know that you're praying for them and tell them how they can pray for you. This is a chance to connect. And so we invite you now to think about someone who you would like to connect with today and send them the peace of Christ. And may the peace of Christ be with you.
Would you please join me in a posture of prayer? Gracious God, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us bring love. Where there is injury, healing. Where there is doubt, solitude. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is fear, faith. Where there is sadness, joy. Abba, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in forgiving that we are forgiven. And it is in loving that we are loved. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Friends, hear and know the good news of the gospel. You are claimed as God's beloved now and forevermore. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I'd like to invite the children of the congregation to gather their attention around, to use your listening ears. Today, I want to talk to you about God. Now, I know it's a little bit of a letdown of a lead for a minister to want to talk to you about God, but I want to tell you about the very nature of God, what God is. To do that, I need a little bit of help from my friends, Frog and Toad. So I have to read you this story that's called The Dream. The Dream. Toad was asleep, and he was having a dream. He was on a stage, and he was wearing a costume. Toad looked out into the dark. Frog was sitting in the theater. A strange voice from far away said, "Presenting the greatest toad in all the world." Toad took a deep bow. Frog looked smaller as he shouted, "Hooray for Toad!" "Toad will now play the piano very well," said the strange voice. Toad played the piano, and he did not miss a note. "Frog," cried Toad, "can you play the piano like this?" "No," said Frog. It seemed to Toad that Frog looked even smaller. Toad will now walk on a high wire and he will not fall down, said the voice. Toad walked on the high wire. Frog, cried Toad, can you do tricks like this? No, peeped Frog, who looked very, very small. Toad will now dance, and he will be wonderful, said the voice. Frog, can you be as wonderful as this? Said Toad as he danced all over the stage. There was no answer. Toad looked out into the theater. Frog was so small that he could not be seen or heard. Frog, said Toad, where are you? There was still no answer. Frog, what have I done? Cried Toad. Then the voice said, the greatest toad will now... Shut up, screamed Toad. Frog, Frog, where have you gone? Toad was spinning in the dark. Come back, Frog, he shouted. I will be lonely. I am right here, said Frog. Frog was standing near Toad's bed. Wake up, Toad, he said. Frog, is that really you? Said Toad. Of course it is me, said Frog. And are you your own right size? Asked Toad. Yes, I think so, said Frog. Toad looked at the sunshine coming through the window. Frog, he said, I am so glad that you came over. I always do, said Frog. Then Frog and Toad ate a big breakfast. And after that, they spent a fine, long day together. I wanted to share this story with you because it's about being together. About being in relationship with the people we love, and how this is more important than being the greatest. That being the greatest is really nothing compared to how wonderful it is to be with those we love. And this is the very heart of who God is. God's own being, at the very heart of who God is. God is about being in relationship. God is about love. God is about being with one another, so close that God is right beside us, even when we don't know. More than being the greatest, what matters to God is relationship.
Our scripture this morning is Romans 8, verses 14 through 17. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if in fact we suffer with Christ, so that we may also be glorified with Christ. May God bless us with understanding. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today is Trinity Sunday. I wonder if you had to describe the Trinity to someone, what would you say? Would you use words? Maybe you would draw a picture, maybe three interlocking circles. Maybe you talk about one element having three states, solid, liquid, and gas. Maybe you'd throw up your hands in the air and say, it's just a mystery. Or maybe the most honest among us would say, who cares? Hopefully, at least a few of you care. Otherwise, this sermon is going to be a bust. But maybe a little art will help to make it more interesting. One of the most famous pieces of art said to depict the Trinity is this work by Rublev. There's a Hebrew Bible story to go with this work, but it's said that it was meant to depict the Trinity. You can see three people with many similarities, but a few differences. Each one of these figures has a halo, suggesting divinity. Each one is wearing blue, the color of the heavens, that was to symbolize God. So we're supposed to see that these three are God, but each is slightly different. The one in the center also wears brown, the color of the earth, reminding us of Jesus Christ, who lived on earth and felt dirt between his toes. And this figure is also touching a cup, reminding us of Christ's presence in the communion cup. The figure on the right wears green, reminding us of growth. And behind this figure is a mountain, which makes us think of mountaintop experiences when God comes close. This is said to be the Holy Spirit. And on the left, there is a figure wearing gold, reminding us of beauty and glory, of the Creator's beautiful works of light, and of the streets of gold spoken of in Revelation. There's a house behind this figure, perhaps reminding us that in God's house there are many rooms. In this work, we might see Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit, all seated around a table looking quite similar, and yet having their own individual traits. But you might be thinking, and what is the point? Why do we need the Trinity? What good has Trinitarianism done me? Isn't it good enough to just say God is mysterious and call it a day? Maybe. Our adult education team has been talking a good deal about how American Christians' faith might influence their politics. It's easy to draw parallels between how a person describes their God and how they believe society should function. We all worship something. We all have some God. Whether we name that God or not, we all have something that we believe is of utmost importance. If your God, or what you see as most important, is a self-sufficient, self-interested, command-giving, exacting, anthropomorphic male deity that is in need of constant praise, you might, when choosing a leader, choose one who is seemingly self-sufficient, self-interested, command-giving, exacting, male, in need of constant praise, because that is what you believe is holiest and best. If you believe God is authoritarian, for you, authoritarian leaders are of God. Now maybe you're thinking that stuff about American Christians sounds more interesting than the Trinity, but she's really gotten off topic. But I promise I'm not. The Trinity. So are we talking about God as an element that exists in multiple forms? Is this about multiple psychological states? Is God the Father, the boss, forcing the Son and Spirit to do his business? The earliest of our theologians, along with many of our current theologians, don't think any of those are quite it. They use this word to describe the Trinity that means dance around. The word is perichoresis, in case you're looking to impress at your next cocktail party. The parts of the Trinity are doing a dance. They are energy moving together to the same music. Each part is equal to the others. Each part is completely dependent on the others for the success of the dance. Each one is completely in tune with the others to make the dance work. They are one. They are all energy, all relationship. That stands in stark contrast to authoritarianism. This kind of Trinitarianism is quite different. God as Trinity is God as a relationship, and as a relationship of equality. The invitation to relationship with God is an invitation to relationship with a relationship. You were not given a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but a spirit of adoption, a spirit of being fully a part of this God relationship. You are not being ordered around. You are in relationship with this energy. You are dancing this dance too. You and me and Jesus and the Spirit and the Creator, we are all in this together. That feels different to me. Being children of the triune God is about finding our way out of systems built on domination and subjugation, and instead finding ourselves in the divine dance of right relationship. That's what it means to me to be a Trinitarian. That's what I'm thinking when I sing Creator, Christ, and Holy Ghost each week in worship. I wonder, what does the Trinity mean to you?
Past year, I've learned a great deal about church. Now, I'm somebody who likes to think that I already knew a fair amount about church, but I learned a lot in the past year. And it's not exactly new things, but I learned that the church is so much more than any one place, so much more than any one person. That we as a community, that we together do the work of being God's people, caring for one another, reaching out with love and support in difficult times, helping all of the ministries of this church to thrive even in the most challenging of circumstances. This is so much more than any one place and any one person. And I am so grateful that we are looking ahead to a year in which once again so much will be possible that had been impossible. And I hope that I will take these lessons with me, that this is about so much more than any one place or any one person, and that all of us together make church possible. Now, we are asking that if folks are intending to pledge to the coming year's church budget, if you have your pledge cards, then we invite you to please send those in. This is the last day of May, and so we were asking that if folks were intending to send in their pledges, please do so soon. We appreciate all of the ways that in our generosity, we do the work of the church together.
Let us join together in prayer. Loving God, we come to you in this time of prayer with perhaps some odd requests. Bless us with anger. Anger at the injustice, oppression, and exploitation our siblings near and far are experiencing. Give us courage to not only pray for, but to fight for justice, freedom, and peace. Bless us with foolishness. foolishness enough to believe in our ability to make a difference in the world. Empower us so that we can do what others might claim cannot be done. Bless us with discomfort. Discomfort at inauthenticity, easy answers, and half-truths, so that we might strive to know more, challenge ourselves to live deeper and open-heartedly. We pray to you with confidence that you hear us and faith that you respond. Spirit God, lead us. We are your children by adoption, joint heirs with our brother Christ, claimed and called. Guide our feet, encompass us with your love. Help us put our love into action. Do not let us get caught up or bogged down by the trivial things in life. Stretch our hearts to be as wide as yours. We pray to you as your Son taught us, to our Creator, Mother, Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Let it breathe on me, let it breathe on me, let the breath.
As our time of worship comes to a close, please take note of these few announcements before we go. Next Sunday, June 6th, following worship is another opportunity to join the discussion about refreshing our covenant and purpose statement. Don't forget to sign up to participate in that discussion. The link to do so can be found in your weekly eBlast email, or you can contact Sally Smiley. We are going to be having a newcomers class. It will be held on Wednesday, June 9th from 8 to 10 p.m. via Zoom. If you would like to know more about that or interested in being a part of it, contact Pastor Lydia. Our next opportunity for outdoor in-person worship will be 9 a.m. on June 13th, weather permitting. Our 11 a.m. virtual online worship service will happen regardless. There will be an opportunity to RSVP for that in-person outdoor service, so be sure to look for that. And following worship, we will have two deacons waiting for you in the virtual chapel should you need an additional time of prayer or a more personal space to connect with someone about what is going on in your life. We hope that you will take that opportunity if you need it. And now, let us join together in singing our closing hymn.
Into your life. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God lift a loving countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen.